what you can see here is this is the spinous process up, right? And this is the spinous process below. So the ligament that is there between the two spinous processes is the interspinous ligament. This ligament, can you see, it's quite thin as compared to the supraspinous ligament, right? Plus it is longitudinal. So what is the property of this? It is thin, it is fibrous, it is connecting two adjacent spines, and it connects it all throughout the length of the spine, all right, from here to here. So the whole length of the spine is connected, all right. Now this interspinous ligament is coming in contact with the supraspinous ligament posteriorly, and it comes in contact with the ligamentum flavum anteriorly, all right. Now next we have to see what is this. This is ligamentum flavum, all right. So can you see, this is the laminae, upper and lower. So it connects the laminae, the upper laminae and the lower laminae. Can you see that this is all the fibers are almost perpendicular to the laminae? So that's why it's known as, the fibers are perpendicular. It is yellow and it is elastic tissue. Okay, so it's a yellow elastic tissue that is perpendicular, that is connecting the inferior surface of the upper laminae and the superior surface of the lower laminae. Now, ligamentum laminae, you know that. So I'll just exit this for. So if you can see me, so you know that the laminae are like, you know, there's a right and the left, right? So similarly, you will have two sections of the ligamentum flavum also. You have the right ligamentum flavum and the left ligamentum flavum, and they fuse and at the apex, all right. They fuse at the midline. So is that understood, that there are two ligamentum flavum at each level and not one? So last, which I explained to you, because it is like this, right? So the right ligamentum flavum and the left, and they fuse in the midline because they're along the laminae. So where does the spinal cord end? So the position of the spinal cord. So it is at lower border of L3 for whom? For whom?
Infants.
Lower border of L3 at birth, okay, for kids. So, and then it reaches where? The lower border of L1
L1.
or upper border of L2 for whom? Adults, all
Adults.
right. So when is this adult level reached of the spinal cord? So this is reached at the age of 12 to 16 years almost. This level is reached, okay, in the kids. So why am I saying lower border of L1? So almost 40% of the patient, 40% of the population, it ends over here. And then the remaining 50% of the population, it ends over here. All right. Some other things that we need to know. What is the length? Length of spinal cord. All right. So in males,
45 centimeters.
correct, 45. So in males, it's 45 centimeter. And in females, it's a little lesser. It is 42 centimeter. All right. What is the weight of the spinal cord? It is 30 grams. Only 30 grams. All right. Next, what we have to understand is the meninges. Okay. So far, I think this would be clear. Just like it, we have it for the brain, we have it for the spinal cord also. So first, what do we have? We have the dural sac. Now, why are we calling this the dural sac? So the dura, which is there, which is the outermost meninge, among all the three meninges, you have dura, arachnoid, and pia, right? So the dura is the outermost. All right. So this dural sleeve, it's called a dural sleeve. It covers the whole length of the spinal cord. All right. It originates from the dura mater in the brain. Okay. So it starts from the foramen magnum all the way down to the S3. Okay, so next we have the subarachnoid space. We call it subarachnoid space. Why? Because we have two membranes which are bound, forming its boundary. All right. So you have the arachnoid membrane. So it's the space between the arachnoid membrane and the pia mater. That is the subarachnoid space. All right. So it is the space between the arachnoid membrane and the pia mater. Now, this arachnoid membrane is, what is the property? It is non-vascular. All right. Pia mater, what is the property? It is a very thin, delicate membrane. It is covering the spinal cord very intimately. Okay. It also covers the blood vessels which are there around the spinal cord. And the gap between this is the subarachnoid space. Okay. Now, what is the contents of the subarachnoid space? What is there within it? All right. So the contents of the subarachnoid space. So you have got trabeculae, Obviously, you have the spinal nerves and you have the CSF. All right. So this is the content of the subarachnoid space. Okay. This image again has been taken from Collins' textbook. Now in this, you can see the curves, right? There are curves of the spine. All right. So there is a cervical curve. There is a thoracic curve, which is also known as the dorsal curve. Then you have the lumbar curve and then you got the sacral curve, right? So the cervical is anterior. Okay. The convexity is anterior. Convexity is posterior over here. Lumbar, again, the convexity is anterior. Sacral, again, the convexity is posterior. All right. Next, what do we need to understand? Which are the, there are some points, which is the lowest point, and then you have the highest point. Okay. So these points and this curvature, we are understanding it in the horizontal plane. Okay. The patient is in the horizontal plane. So what they notice, the lowest point, which is there, it is T5. So thoracic, the T5 vertebra is the lowest point of the curvature. And then you have the highest point, which is the L3. All right. So L3 is the highest point. Now, why are these curves important for us? Because this determines the distribution of our anesthetic drug. All right. So when you give a hyperbaric, a heavy drug, so when you deposit the drug here, okay, L3, L4 or L4, L5, you have done lumbar puncture, you have deposited drug, you made the patient supine. The drug is going to descend down and settle over here at T5. So the hyperbaric drug is heavy. It goes along the gravity and it's going to descend and settle over here. All right. Then if you have a hypobaric drug, obviously, because it's lighter than CSF, effect of gravity won't occur like this on it. So it will accumulate over here itself at the L3 itself. All right. So that's why knowing these curvatures is important for us. Then we have certain abnormal curvatures. All right. So we have got kyphosis, right? So kyphosis is what here? Kyphosis is seen in the thoracic vertebrae, all right? So it is extreme anterior posterior. That means extreme curvature occur over here. That is kyphotic spine, all right? Then we may have lordosis. So lordosis is what? Lumbar lordosis. So this is also extreme curvature over here of the lumbar spine. This is a lumbar lordosis. Then we have scoliosis. So scoliosis is what? The lateral curvature of the spine. Spine is not in the midline. It's curved either towards the right or towards the left. So what are the layers that we are, what are the structures that we are encountering? Okay, when we are puncturing, when you're doing a lumbar puncture, what are the layers that we are encountering? So first we have the skin and the subcutaneous tissue, right? After that we have what? We saw the ligaments, right? So we have the supraspinous ligament. Then we have the interspinous ligament, right? Then we have ligamentum flavum. So then we encountered, after the skin subcutaneous, we have encountered all the three ligaments. All right. Then we have encountered the epidural space. We have not reached the dura yet. We have reached the epidural space. After the epidural space, we have punctured the dura and then we have reached the CSF, right? That is when we get the tap. So these are the structures that are encountered during a spinal puncture. All right. Next, what we need to know is the circulation of the spinal cord. What is the blood supply? One anterior spinal artery and two posterior. Anterior two-thirds will be supplied by the single anterior spinal artery. The two posterior spinal arteries will supply the remaining. So the posterior one-third of the spinal cord. Okay. Now, only this much blood supply is not enough, right? So there is going to be reinforcement. Okay. There are going to be additional small arteries which are going to be supplying the spinal cord as well. All right. So these are known as, the reinforcement is provided by radicular arteries. They are called radicular arteries. So we have got the spinal radicular arteries. Next, we have to know about the venous drainage, right? So which are the veins which are going to be draining it? So there are six veins, okay? Next, we'll do the venous drainage. So there are six veins which are draining, all right? Again, so we have got two median and four lateral veins. Okay, it's not very difficult. So there are two median veins, there are four lateral veins. These are longitudinal veins. They are called longitudinal. Why are they called longitudinal? Because they are going all along the length, right? So there are two median longitudinal veins and there are two lateral longitudinal veins because they're going along the length. Now, two median longitudinal veins, again, they have to drain the anterior part and the posterior part, right? So there are two. So it's going to be the anterior and the posterior. Okay, in the median part. Then you have the lateral longitudinal veins. Again, it has to drain the anterior and the posterior part. So again, we have got two anterior, and you have got two posterior. Now, these veins, how are they draining? Okay, so there are these six veins which are taking the blood from the spinal cord, right? Draining the venous blood. It will empty into what? The internal vertebral plexus. So these are the names for one and the same thing. So you've got the internal vertebral plexus, also called Batson's, also called epidural venous plexus. All right. So these veins are going to drain into the internal vertebral plexus, internal plexus. Okay. So now there's an internal plexus. So obviously there's going to be an external plexus also, right? So these internal plexus and the external plexus, which are there, they're communicating with each other always. All right. And these veins don't have, these plexus don't have any valves. So they're able to freely communicate. Okay. Now the venous blood is going to drain into the internal vertebral plexus, external vertebral plexus. All right. And finally drains into the what? Azygous, hemiazygous vein. And then ultimately goes to the superior vena cava. And that's how it drains. How much is blood going to the gray matter? Okay. So it is 40 ml per 100 gram of tissue per minute. Okay. And white matter of the spinal cord. Okay, so we're referring to spinal cord. It is going to be 12 ml per 100 gram of tissue per minute. Okay, so this is going to be the supply. Okay, the perfusion. Now, we know autoregulation used to happen in the brain. So there's going to be autoregulation in the spinal cord also. So what is the range of autoregulation? So autoregulation occurs here also. And the range, so the range is what? It is the mean arterial BP that I'm talking about, right? That between this much mean arterial BP, there will be autoregulation. So that is 60 to 120. So from 60 to 120 millimeters of mercury, when the mean arterial BP is there, the blood circulation will not be affected. All right. So if it goes below 60, the MAP goes below 60, that means what? Hypoperfusion will occur now in parallel. And if it goes above 120, then hyperperfusion will occur in parallel, right? So you remember this kind of graph we had seen. So it is between 60 to 120 that the perfusion is going to be constant. Okay, this perfusion is going to be constant. This is the range of autoregulation for the spinal cord. Now, so what is the spinal cord perfusion pressure? So just like we had learned cerebral perfusion pressure, right? So we need to know what is the perfusion pressure of the spinal cord. So same thing, mean arterial BP, right? Mean arterial BP minus some pressure. So in the CNS, what we had learned, it was the intracranial pressure. So here there is no intracranial pressure. Here it is CSF pressure. All right. So it is the mean BP minus the CSF pressure will give you the perfusion pressure of the spinal cord. What is going to affect the perfusion of the spinal cord? So if there is going to be hypoxia, all right, hypoxia, hypercarbia, what will it cause? It will increase the blood flow, right? Then you have hypocarbia, you have hypothermia. These conditions will decrease the spinal cord blood flow. Okay, so CSF is produced by what method? So it is produced by a technique known as ultrafiltration. It's an active process. It needs energy, all right, ultrafiltration. So CSF is produced by whom? All right. So it's produced by the choroid plexus, which is the, what is it? There's a network of blood vessels, right? Around the spinal cord. So there's going to be blood vessels. I told you pia mater is very closely attached to the blood vessels, right? So this pia mater has got ependymal cells. All right. So the ependymal cells, it is through that the filtration occurs and there is secretion of the CSF. Okay. It is via the ependymal cells of the pia mater. Produced at the rate of 0.4 ml per minute. If you take it in terms of hours, that would be what? 25 ml per hour. Okay. That would come to how much? 600 ml per day. This is the amount of CSF produced. How much time does it take for the whole CSF to get replaced? So for the whole CSF to get replaced, it takes 6 hours. All right. For all of the CSF to get replaced. Now, the CSF secretion is under whose control? Is it under sympathetic control or parasympathetic control? So it is under the sympathetic control that CSF secretion occurs. All right. Next point. Now we know all about CSF secretion. What about CSF absorption? Right. So CSF is absorbed by arachnoid villi. All right. This term must be heard. Right. So it's absorbed by the arachnoid villi. Ultimately, it finds its way up to the superior sagittal sinus. So what is the composition? So you know the CSF has got proteins and glucose, right? Protein content is 15 to 45, glucose is 50 to 80. Then sodium. What is the sodium content? 140 to 150 milliequivalent per liter. The chloride content is 120 to 130 milliequivalent per liter. Bicarb is how much? 25 to 30 milliequivalent per liter. And what is the pH? 7.4 to 7.6. So these are a few values about what is the composition of CSF and how much of what is there. Specific gravity of CSF is 1.003 to 1.009. All right, this is a specific gravity. What is the total volume of CSF? 120 ml to 150 ml, right? But how much is present in the spinal cord? Because right now we're talking about spinal cord. So the volume around the spinal cord is 20 ml. 110 mm of H2O. This is the pressure in the supine position of the CSF. Okay. So next we'll understand what is the CSF circulation. Circulation of CSF. So we have first, you know, it's produced in the choroid plexus, right? From choroid plexus, where does it go? To the lateral ventricles. Right? From the lateral ventricle, where does it go? To foramen of Monroe. Right? From foramen of Monroe, next, the third ventricle. Yes. From third ventricle, where does it go? Aqueduct of Sylvius. From aqueduct of Sylvius, where does it go? Fourth ventricle. And from the fourth ventricle, ultimately to the foramen of Lushka and Magendie. And then finally to the subarachnoid space in the spinal cord, right? So this is the order in which the CSF circulation occurs. So Stout's principles, the height of the block. Pragya has got a more specific gravity. Okay, the height of the block will be more. If the CSF pressure is less, the height of the block will be more. If the volume is more, height of the block will be more. Lesser time to take to fix, more will be the height which will be achieved. More concentration of drug use, more will be the height. Okay, so this is known as Stout's principles. If you remember, there was a table in Miller's, right? There is a table, okay, about the factors which are important for affecting the height of the block which is achieved, right? So now these were Stout's. Initially, he gave these principles, right? But after that, then there was detailed study about each factor, about how it affects the height of the block which is achieved, the spinal block. So there are certain factors, there are drug factors, right? Drug related factors like dose, varicity, volume, concentration, temperature of drug, viscosity, if you're adding any additives or not. So all of these are there. Then there are certain things which are patient factors. All right. So in that, what is the volume of the CSF in that patient? What is the age of the patient? Is the patient pregnant or not? Or patients, is the patient obese or what? What is his height? What is his weight? Right. How is the spine anatomy? Any kyphosis, scoliosis, right? What is the intra-abdominal pressure? Correct. So then after that, even the procedure related factors. So what is the position of the patient that you give in the spinal? And immediately after positioning, what position have you given? Have you given lateral? Have you given supine? Have you given head low, head high position? All right. Then epidural, have you injected the epidural after giving the spinal immediately? Then after, what is the level of the injection means? At what level have you conducted the epidural injection or the spinal injection, right? Then what about the currents in the CSF? Okay. The direction of the bevel of the needle. Okay. And what kind of needle have you used? So there are many factors which are going to be affecting the block height. But there are some factors which are very important. Okay. So among the drug factors, the two most important factors are going to be the dose of the drug and the baricity of the drug. Okay. So now we'll understand how the drug dose is more important than even the volume or the concentration. So drug dose, what do I mean? I don't mean, see, volume of the drug is what, 2 ml. If I'm giving 2 ml of 0.5% bupivacaine, that means the concentration is 0.5%. The volume is 2 ml. But what is the dose? this dose is more important factor than that volume or the concentration of bupivacaine. Okay, so dose is equal to volume of the drug into the concentration. So if I tell you that I am giving a volume 2 ml of bupivacaine, concentration 0.5% hyperbaric. So what does this mean? I'm giving 2 ml, 0.5%, so 0.5 gram in 100 per deciliter. This is the meaning of a
Jesus.
percentage. So this is 2 into what? 500 upon, so this give what? 10 mg drug. So this value 10 mg is a most important determinant of what level you will achieve than the ml, then the how much volume or the concentration. All right. So if you have used more volume of a lesser concentration, that is not a very important factor. This is a most important factor. How many milligrams of the drug are you depositing? So what is baricity? Baricity is basically you're comparing densities of two things, right? So you're comparing the density of the local anesthetic upon the density of CSF. Basically, you're seeing the comparison of the densities between the local anesthetic and the CSF at a particular temperature. So this density value keeps changing with temperature. All right. And what is the unit of density? Density is weight upon volume. So density is basically a value. It is the weight of that substance in a particular volume. Okay. It's weight upon volume is density. This is given at a particular temperature. So as the temperature fluctuates, density also will fluctuate. What is the relation between temperature and density? So if I increase the temperature, the density will decrease. It will become less dense. Okay, that is the relation between density and temperature. So now there are three baricities that we know: hypobaric, hyperbaric, and isobaric. All right. So what is a hypobaric? Hypobaric is the one whose density of the local anesthetic is lesser than that of the CSF. All right. So that's a, that becomes hypobaric. Then you have hyperbaric, right? Density of the local anesthetic is more than the CSF. So hyperbaric. Same densities, local and CSF, isobaric. Temperature is fluctuating with density. All right. So at room temperature, what is the room temperature in the OT? 23 degrees, 24 degrees. That temperature is lesser than our body temperature, which is 37 degrees, right? This baricity value that we get, okay. So the baricity value that we are talking about over here is at body temperature at 37 degrees. This value, whenever we refer to baricity, we are referring to at 37 degrees. So whenever it is at room temperature, our drug, the baricity of the drug changes. Because if I'm telling that this drug is hyperbaric, it is hyperbaric in an environment of 37 degrees, which is the body temperature. All right. It is not hyperbaric at room temperature, which is 23 degrees. Okay, so it is that is how it affect it's affected by changes in temperature. So now at room temperature is colder than body temperature, right? So what will happen? The density is in more as temperature, what happened? Temperature dropped, density is more, baricity is more. Okay, so why is this important for an isobaric? So isobaric is what? Same baricity as CSF, but provided it's at 37 degrees, right? Now temperature has dropped. So isobaric is no longer isobaric. Its baricity has increased. It has become hyperbaric. Relatively, it has become hyperbaric. So when you're using an isobaric bupivacaine, that means what? Bupivacaine without dextrose. So which is the isobaric bupivacaine that we have? The vials, right? They don't have any additive in it. It's 0.5% plain bupivacaine. So that is isobaric bupivacaine. You're understanding? That bupivacaine is isobaric. So in case, see, this also bupivacaine, isobaric bupivacaine used to be used in spinal anesthesia previously. Now we are all using hyperbaric. So that time what used to happen, this isobaric did not behave as an isobaric. It used to behave as a hyperbaric. So what they used to do, they used to warm it up in their hand so that they bring it to the body temperature before injecting it into the CSF. They don't want that temperature fluctuation within the CSF. The CSF is 37 degrees, drug is less, you know, colder. So it will not behave correctly over there in that environment. CSF density is 1.0059 grams per liter. All right. So this, if the density of the local anesthetic is more than this value, then that becomes hyperbaric. If the density is same as this, it is isobaric. If the density is less than this, it is hypobaric. Okay. Next, if you add sugar, if you add dextrose to local anesthetic, it becomes hyperbaric. If you add normal, if you add distilled water, okay, sterile water to the local anesthetic, it becomes hypobaric. What will happen? You have deposited a drug over here. because of gravitational effect and because it is a heavy drug, it is hyperbaric in the CSF. It is heavier than CSF. It's going to dip down. Okay, when the patient is in the supine position. All right, it will go to the low point. Now, how does it move to the low point? We need to understand this. So this is, again, something related with patient positioning also. So we'll cover it together only. Okay. So now the patient is in supine position. Now, as I told you, patient factors, CSF, volume, age, pregnancy, position of the patient. So this patient position is in the procedure. So this is very important factor for determining the height. I have deposited a drug here in the sitting position. I made the patient supine. As soon as the patient was made supine, the hyperbaric drug, which is there, it will have a bimodal spread. Bimodal spread, which means what? It's going to dip down into this curvature, into the thoracic curve. It's also going to dip down over here into the sacrococcygeal curve. So it's going to go drip going in two directions, okay, when the patient is in supine position. So that's why this is known as bimodal spread in the supine position when I give a hyperbaric drug. All right. Next, if I make this patient in lithotomy, suppose I gave the spinal in the sitting position or lateral position, whatever. I made him supine and I gave him a lithotomy position. What did the lithotomy position do? So this lumbar lordosis, which is there, this lumbar curve has flattened. The lumbar curve has now become quite flat. It has become very flat. Okay. So now what this flattening of the curve has made it go in a uniformity. Okay. So it almost becomes like this, almost like straight. So flattening of the lumbar lordosis will cause no bimodal spread. So now there is no like bimodal spread. There is a more uniform spread upwards in a lithotomy position. A more uniform spread upwards is expected. Now, if you are giving a hyperbaric drug and you're keeping the patient in sitting position, obviously the drug is going to be heavy. Patient is sitting, so drug is going to be heavy. It's going to settle down, right? So it's going to block what? The lower lumbar and the sacral segments, right? So this is known as saddle block. You all know this. You need to know something that is known as a sump effect. Okay, over here, right? This is a lumbar lordosis and it goes in two different directions. All right, there's a bimodal spread. Now, what happens is that from the high point over here, L3, this the sacral curve, which is there, this curve, the sacral one, it is a very sudden and steep. It is very sudden and steep. Okay, so what happens? This drug which is there, it tends to go more quantity goes here because this is more steep, this curve. Okay. So there is almost vertical curve. It is more steep. More amount of drug lands up coming towards here. Okay. And migration into the caudal area. So this is the caudal area. This is known as sump effect. Again, I don't think it's explained in Miller's. So this is known as sump effect. That the lumbar, beyond the lumbar lotus is the sacral curve. The sacral curve is very steep, very vertical. More drug lands up descending over here. That is why after giving a hyperbaric drug, you might have to give the patient a head low. Why you want to give a head low? Because you want to prevent the drug, more drug coming here. You want to encourage the drug to go here, right? You want more drug to go there, not here. So to avoid this sump effect, what you do, you give a head low position in a hyperbaric drug. I'm talking all about hyperbaric drugs now. Okay. Now we have to understand isobaric. So isobaric has got what? Same density as CSF, right? Isobaric drug, the position does not affect it. The movement of the drug is not affected by the position. Spread is not affected by the position. Height of the block is not affected by the position. Okay. Remember this. What happens? You give the drug at L3, L4, all the drug will collect at L3, L4. That is what isobaric drug does. Okay. So it will puddle at the level at which you have given the injection. Okay. Next, hypobaric drug. So hypobaric drug is what? It's lighter than CSF, right? Its density is less. So what's going to happen? If you give a hypobaric drug in sitting position, can you imagine what's going to happen? The drug is just going to go up. Direct high spinal, if you give it in a sitting position. You can't. Because that drug is going to be lighter than CSF. It's going to ascend up. So we can't give it in sitting. So what position is hyperbaric drug given in? It's given in prone position. And in prone position, then will I give a head low or a head high? I will give a head low. Okay. So you are giving it in the prone position with an 8-degree head low. Okay. because you and you cannot give it in sitting because you might cause a inadvertent high spinal anesthesia with a hypobaric drug. Okay. Another important factor which is going to affect the height is the epidural injection. So it's known as epidural volume extension. Okay. So if I give a patient spinal, okay, suppose I give a patient 3 cc of spinal anesthesia, spinal drug, and I have also secured an epidural for this patient. If I within of I've just given the spinal and I immediately, activate the epidural, or maybe I inject some normal saline in the epidural, what's going to happen? There will be distension in the epidural space, right? Because of the normal saline that you have injected or the drug that you have injected in the epidural. Because of which, what is going to happen? The dural sleeve, which is there, is going to get compressed, in which the CSF is there. The dural sleeve is getting compressed. Level will go high. All right. So this epidural injection after spinal is an important cause for increasing the height of the spinal block. Okay. So when is this going to be useful? When you want to give a less. You want to give less concentration of drug. You want to give less dose of the spinal drug because maybe the patient is hemodynamically compromised, right? So you can use this technique called as epidural volume extension. Okay. Side effects are fewer, recovery is also faster, and there is better hemodynamic stability for this patient if you do this. Okay. But in case if you've given a good amount of, like, it's a long duration surgery and you've given like a young patient and like 4 cc drug and in that and that patient is already, like going to get a good spinal anesthesia level. In that patient, if you're going to inject, normal saline in the epidural, it's going to cause further increase in the height, which you don't want of the block. Okay. So understand where you need to do use this technique. Okay. Then the level of needle injection. So they have seen that when you inject the needle, if instead of injecting at L4, L5, you're injecting at L3, L4, they have seen that one space higher block is achieved. Okay. And this is seen with which drug? Isobaric bupivacaine. This is applicable only for isobaric bupivacaine. What I told you, isobaric bupivacaine will puddle where it is, right? So this is applicable at one space higher you will give, you get one segment higher block, and that is going to be important for isobaric bupivacaine, the level of your needle. Okay. Next, we have to understand barbotouch. So barbotouch, you must have heard many people use this term. So what is barbotouch? So basically, you take your drug in the syringe, right? You inject it into the CSF. Again, you aspirate. If you have injected 2 mL of the drug, you aspirate again 2 mL. Again, you inject. Again, you re-aspirate 2 mL. Again, you inject. So when you keep doing this, this is known as barbotouch. It was introduced by Beer. And barbotouch causes what? Can you understand? Repeated aspiration, injection means how much turbulence is getting produced in the CSF and the currents that are generating in the CSF. So by doing this, what they saw is that spinal anesthesia level can be, you can increase the height of the block. All right. So this barbotouch is understood, right? Then the direction of the needle. So if I'm inserting, like if these are the spines, all right, and if I'm inserting the needle here, so if I'm angulating, higher will be the level of the block. Okay. More cranially, my needle is directed. Obviously, parallel to the spinous process, you don't want to hit it. Okay, so more cranially you're going, you have a steep angle, you will get ha more higher will be the spread of the drug, cephalid spread. Okay. Next, the speed of injection. So the speed should not be too fast, should not be too slow, it should be 0.2 mL per second. Okay, then CSF volume is also an important factor which affects, the height of the block that is achieved. So now, in obese patients, why do we have less CSF volume? Because they have got epidural fat, right? Plus, they've got increase in the abdominal size, right? So these are the reasons why the CSF volume is less. Then, in the old patients, age is also an important factor, right? Again, in relation to CSF volume, because patients who are older, they have, first of all, their CSF volume is lesser. Second, their nerves are more sensitive to the action of the local anesthetic. Nerve roots are more sensitive. Okay. Next, for gender. So what they saw that the CSF is more dense. Density of CSF. Density of CSF they saw is more dense in the males than females. So this is not appreciated much in clinical practice, but theoretically they say that the density of CSF in males is more than that in the females. They also see that when you give a male patient a lateral position in spinal, so you give spinal in lateral position, males have got broader shoulders. So because of this, having broad shoulders, they are inadvertently in the head, like in a head up position, because their shoulders are so broad, their shoulders are broad, right? So broad shoulders means what? They're going to be somewhat in the head up position. Female patients, they've got wider hips. So they might go inadvertently in the head low position because of those wide hips. Okay. Again, this is just theoretical. Nothing supports it. Okay. Then pregnant patients, even they are important, right? So IV, now because of this gravid uterus is compressing the IVC, right? And then there are alternate channels. So there'll be congestion of the epidural venous plexus, the internal venous plexus, which I explained to you. Because of which, what happens? The dural sac space is reduced, CSF volume has become less, and there will be higher ascent, okay, of the block height. And additionally, progesterone. So high progesterone. Progesterone is responsible for making the nerves more sensitive, okay, to the action of local anesthetic. The next is going to be the direct effects of spinal anesthesia, okay? So there are three sites where the local anesthetic is going to act, okay? So the first site I told you is the nerve roots. We all know it's the nerve roots. The CSF bathes the nerve roots. So the local anesthetic, which is enters the CSF, is going to go and act on the nerve roots. Okay. The second is the dorsal root ganglion. All right. The dorsal root ganglion is the second site. And the third is going to be what? The spinal cord itself, but it's very limited. I told you almost negligible action on the spinal cord. Okay. The main action is on the spinal nerve roots. Secondary action is on the dorsal root ganglion. Okay, and then finally, minimal action on the spinal cord. I'm going to determine. So first is going to be the size of the nerve. Remember this, okay? So smaller fibers are more susceptible. Second, what is going to affect? Myelination, the nodes of Ranvier. So what they have said that the ones which are having more myelin and far away nodes. So you remember this is the way the axons are and you had these myelin coverings and these were the nodes of Ranvier. This image you remember? So if you have got more myelination, thicker myelination, and if these nodes are far away from each other, that means it's going to be resistant to the penetration of the local anesthetic. This nerve fiber will be resistant. Okay. So if there is more myelination and far away, so far away nodes of Ranvier and more myelination means what? It will be more resistant. These nerves will be more resistant. Then what is the third factor which is going to affect? The frequency at which the nerve transmission is occurring. Okay. In this, what they said, the ones which are low frequency are less sensitive and high frequency are more. So these factors you really need to remember. So first is the fiber size. Small fibers are more susceptible. Second, the myelination and nodes of Ranvier. Okay. More thickly myelinated, more resistant. More far away nodes of Ranvier, more resistant. Then frequency. If it is low frequency of impulses, less resistant. Okay. More less sensitive. And high frequency, more sensitive. Okay. So the nerve fibers which are conducting at a higher frequency are going to be more sensitive. Most important, now remember this is very important. So what is the sequence? What is this vasomotor block? So to the skin, whatever capillaries, blood supply to the skin is there, they will undergo vasodilation. Okay, the blood vessels will dilate. Cutaneous blood flow to the skin will increase. Okay, so that is the first thing that happens. The vasomotor block occurs. Okay, followed by which what? The cold temperature fibers are blocked. So this is the second block which occurs. All right. Then the patient perceives, what will he feel? He feels warm. Already vasomotor block is occurring. Okay. So there's going to be increased cutaneous blood supply. Additionally, the sensation of cold is blocked. So the patient will sense what? Warm. He will sense warmth, right? After this, temperature fibers are completely blocked. So now he cannot discriminate. He cannot discriminate between hot and cold. He was telling you hot. Now he cannot understand anything. Next, what is happening? Slow pain fibers are blocked. So slow pain fibers are blocked. Then you have the fast pain. So you just remember after temperature, you're going to have the pain fibers which are going to be blocked. Okay. So temperature. So first you had the vasomotor. Remember this. Then you had the temperature. Then you had the pain. Next, after pain, what's going to go? Tactile. So tactile is what? Touch. Tactile is lost. So that means the touch is gone. After touch, what is gone? Motor. Motor is lost. Okay. Then sense of pressure. is lost. And then finally, you have got proprioception. That means joint position. So proprioception, this order is very important. You should remember what's going to go first, okay, and what's going to go last. So even after giving the spinal, for some time, the patient might feel his joint position. He might tell you that, you know, you are moving my leg. He is feeling that because of joint position. Okay.